Jesus is alive. Good morning and happy Easter to you and to your family. Thank you for joining us here at our live stream of the worship service for Tremont Baptist Church. I'm so glad that you could join us today. If you are part of our church family, we again want you to know how much we miss you, and we look forward to that day that we could gather again to sing and pray and rejoice and celebrate Jesus. Until then, I'm so thankful that we have this opportunity to come into your home like this. If you're not part of our church family and you are just checking us out online or you stumbled across this recording, we are so glad that you are here, and we want you to know that we love you and we care about you. We invite you to connect with us through our website, tremontbaptist.org. There is, you will find a way to email us or call us. You can submit a prayer request by clicking on the prayer tab. If you're part of our church family, we're grateful for your continued and faithful giving. You can do that by clicking on the Give tab. You can also find previous recordings of our services and additional helps for your spiritual life. In Acts chapter 2, we read these words from the very first sermon preached by Peter after the resurrection and ascension of Jesus. Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge. And you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. God raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and poured out what you now see and hear. Therefore, let all Israel and all the world be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. Let's pray. Our Father and God, we praise you for your love that sent Jesus to die on the cross for our sins. We praise you for your grace that redeems us through faith in your Son. We praise you for your power that raised Jesus from the dead. And we praise you for your promise that Jesus will return and gather us together. Until that day, give us hope, joy, peace, and courage. May we share and show the love of Christ to the nations. Bless our worship so that it's pleasing and acceptable to you. O Lord, save the lost, strengthen your church, and glorify your name. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Hear this from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. For what I received I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day, according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. Today we celebrate a risen Savior. Christ the Lord has risen today. Will you join us and sing along at home as we sing that?
Christ the Lord is risen today.
Christ is indeed risen. He is worthy of all our worship and praise today.
Rise, O church, and lift your voices. Christ has conquered death and hell. Sing as all the earth rejoices. Worship, worship Christ.
Psalm 15. Lord, who may dwell in your sacred tent? Who may live on your holy mountain? The one whose walk is blameless, who does what is righteous, who speaks the truth from their heart, whose tongue utters no slander, who does no wrong to a neighbor and casts no slur on others, who despises a vile person but honors those who fear the Lord, who keeps an oath even when it hurts and does not change their mind, who lends money to the poor without interest, who does not accept a bribe against the innocent. Whoever does these things will never be shaken.
Would you again bow in prayer? There in your home, in the quietness of your heart, would you praise the Lord? He is worthy of all your praise. He is good, gracious, and kind. Repent of your sin. Turn from the wrong that you've done and turn back to the Lord who forgives and offers grace and mercy. Ask the Lord for the help that you need. Ask for God's blessings upon your friends and family and loved ones who are hurting, who might be far from God. Ask that the Lord would be at work in their lives, bring them to Himself. Now yield yourself to God. Surrender your all to Him. Your life belongs to Him. Give it gladly and willingly. And now will you join me in praying this prayer our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
That first Easter morning, the joy that would have been experienced by those who went to the tomb and found it empty, but were told that He had been raised from the dead, after Mary encountered Jesus in the garden, after the disciples saw Jesus as He came into that inner room, what joy and gladness they would have experienced in their hearts. Today we celebrate and rejoice with them at a risen Savior.
See what a morning gloriously bright, with the dawning of hope in Jerusalem. Folded the grave clothes to with light, as the angels announced Christ is risen. See God's salvation plan, wrought in love, born in pain, paid in sacrifice. Fulfilled in Christ, amen, for He lives, Christ is risen from the dead. See Mary weeping, where is He laid? As in sorrow she turns from an empty tomb, hears a voice speaking, calling her name. It's the Master, the Lord, raised to life again. The voice that spans the years, speaking life, stirring hope, bringing peace to us. Father, Ancient of Days, through the Spirit is risen from the dead.
Amen and amen.
I invite you to take your Bibles and open them to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28. What's the most defining moment in your life? What is it that shapes everything about you? Day in and day out, week after week, year after year, what is it that is most crucial and critical? Is it your marriage? Maybe the birth of a child. Maybe it was the day that you were hired or the day you retired. It could be a traumatic event, an accident, a loss, a diagnosis. When we think about our nation, there have been events that have defined generations: the Declaration of Independence, the Emancipation Proclamation, the surprise attack on Pearl Harbor, the assassination of John F. Kennedy, the terrorist attacks on September 11th. Moving out more broadly, as we think about the scope of world history, there are events that have defined the world for us even today. The fall of the Roman Empire, the Black Plague that swept Europe, and Columbus landing on Hispaniola so long ago. And of course, there are others that we could think about. There are events, there are moments that have shaped our personal lives and world history. But friend, there is nothing more defining than the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. Listen to what the Gospel of Matthew chapter 28 says. After the Sabbath at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He is risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.'" So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid, yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." Let's again pray. Forever, O Lord, your word is settled. Your faithfulness endures to all generations. What we have read here today is absolutely true. So grant us the grace necessary to receive it and believe it. Let your word and the resurrection of your Son shape and define our lives. Let the words that I speak and the meditation of all of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you. O Lord, save the lost. Save those who wander. Bring those who are far, far away close to yourself. Give strength and hope to your children. Glorify your name. We ask this with help from the Holy Spirit, who reigns with you and our resurrected and reigning Savior, Jesus Christ, one God, now and forever. Amen. Jesus was dead. He'd been nailed to a cross by the Romans at the urging and manipulation of the Jewish authorities. After being hastily buried late Friday evening, the tomb was sealed and the disciples mourned. Early Sunday morning, the women made their way to the garden where the tomb was located. And that's when everything changed for them. The resurrection of Jesus Christ from the grave is the defining moment in time and eternity. It's the resurrection that brings our salvation to fulfillment. The salvation that began at the cross is completed by the resurrection of Jesus. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 15 that if Christ is not raised from the dead, then we are without hope, we have no future, and our faith is worthless and futile. But praise God, Jesus has been raised, Jesus is alive, and He reigns, and this changes everything for us. Friends, I want you to see from Matthew 28 how the resurrection of Jesus changes things for us, what the resurrection does and how it ought to define our lives. First of all, I want you to see that the resurrection shakes the whole world. Verse 2 tells us that there was a violent earthquake. Angels descended to roll the stone back. And there was a physical tremor in creation when Christ rose from the dead. But spiritual tremors can still be felt 2,000 years later. The resurrection of Jesus has shaken the entire world. For some, the resurrection has shaken them out of a spiritual stupor, and they've been awakened to the glorious gospel truths, and they now believe. But for others, the resurrection has shaken them, and they shrink back. Verse 4 describes how the guards were so terrified, they shook and they fainted with terror. No one is indifferent to the resurrection of Jesus. People either see it as the greatest event in history or they see it as a farce and a fairy tale. Either way, you cannot come to the tomb and walk away unchanged. A few years ago, Sarah wanted to go to Niagara Falls for family vacation. I honestly was not all that interested. I was much more interested in taking a little excursion into Canada so I could watch a baseball game in Toronto. I had this little dream of watching a baseball game in all the major league stadiums. And so as she was planning and as we were talking about this, I thought, oh yeah, sure, big deal. It's a waterfall. Who cares? But then we got there. And I was profoundly affected by it. The power, the beauty, the splendor of the falls, the sights, the sounds, the feel of the mist, the smell of the water, it all seized me. What I had once thought was no big deal, it's just some water, became a powerful grip on me. And I wanted to see the falls from every angle. I wanted to watch the water pour over the rocks. I wanted to hear the roar, and I couldn't get enough of it. I thought 5 minutes was more than enough time to see it until I experienced it. And I could have spent days at the falls. Friends, maybe for you the resurrection of Jesus is like Niagara Falls was for me. I thought it was no big deal. There's a town that has been built up around the falls, and it's full of kitschy shops and tacky commercialization that trivialize the falls in some ways. For you, perhaps the resurrection of Jesus is no big deal, and you see some of the bizarre and the strange Christian culture nonsense that has grown up and popped up around the resurrection. The bad music, the mediocre art, the nonsense, the scandal and the hypocrisy. And so maybe you are tempted to walk away from the resurrection thinking that there are more interesting things in the world. But today I invite you to come close and carefully consider authentic Christianity. Not the kitsch, not the scandal, not the hypocrisy and the mockery that has grown up around genuine Christianity, but the true thing, the actual Christian faith. I invite you to pull out a Bible and read the Gospel of John and meet the real Jesus, the true Jesus, who loves you, who died on the cross for your sins, who rose from the dead, and is one day coming again. Get to know real, authentic Christianity. And if you do, I promise your world will be shaken and everything will change. Dear Christian, perhaps you've forgotten just how awesome the resurrection of Jesus is. We've become so familiar with the story of that first Easter morning, we kind of go through the motions and we move on. So come back. Join Mary and the women at the tomb and be awed once again. Jesus is risen from the dead and is alive forevermore, and it changes everything. The second thing I want you to notice is that the resurrection quiets our fears. The women gathered to the tomb and they were afraid. Their hopes had been shattered. The one that they loved had been brutally murdered on the cross. The future was unknown and uncertain. And then the angel came. And angels are terrifying beings. We know this because almost every time we read about an angel appearing to people in Scripture, the angel has to say, "Don't be afraid." People are afraid when they encounter angels. The angels tell the women that Jesus is alive, that they don't have to be afraid, that there is hope. And they become hopeful, but verse 8 says that their joy at the news of Jesus' resurrection is mingled with fear. And so when Jesus appears to them, he once again says, "Do not be afraid." What is it that you're afraid of today? Like the women were, are you afraid of the future? Because of the resurrection of Jesus, you don't have to be afraid about tomorrow. Our future is secure in Jesus. Jesus is alive and he's leading us through these days to come. Are you afraid of death? There is no need to fear death because Jesus has conquered death and the grave. He is the final word, not death. Jesus assures us that when our faith and trust is in him, when our life here on earth is done, today we'll be with him in paradise. Are you afraid of being condemned and rejected by God? Don't be afraid. Jesus has paid for all of your sins. In Christ, you are accepted and beloved by the Father. Jesus paid too high a price for you to ever abandon you. You'll never be rejected by him. Are you afraid that this is all a trick, a hoax, that Christianity is a lie? Have no fear. We have the witness of countless believers who tell us that they've experienced the power of the resurrection. We have eyewitness accounts of people who saw the empty tomb, who touched the resurrected and risen Lord. We know that Jesus is alive. And dear friend, if you are a Christian, you know in your heart that Christ is alive because he is with you. And you sense and know his presence. We are only afraid when we lose sight of Jesus and we forget that because he's alive, we'll always be taken care of. I love the line in Bill Gaither's song, "Because He Lives." It says, "Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, life is worth the living, just because he lives." Friends, we can face uncertain and fearful days because he lives. Third, the resurrection fills us with joy. The women were overjoyed when they heard the news. When they saw Jesus, they fell to his feet in overwhelmed worship. Jesus is alive. He's with us. He is God. He is our Savior. And he's making all things well. Knowing that Jesus is with me gives me joy. Knowing that Jesus is working all things together for my good gives me joy in the hardest and most difficult of circumstances. Knowing that Jesus has prepared a place for me gives me joy, even in the face of death. Lasting and eternal joy does not come from this world. It comes through Jesus who rose from the dead. Friend, today you can have an experience and live out joy because our true joy comes in Jesus. This joy will cause us to rejoice and worship Him. It will fill our lives so that even though we have temporary tears and painful circumstances, underneath it all is this abiding joy that comes from the Lord because Jesus is alive. One of the ways that we Christians can be a blessing and be a help to others is by being filled with joy in the Lord and living each day, facing each circumstance with underlying and ever-present joy. I think of my friend Judy, who, despite being diagnosed with cancer and going through the hardships of treatment, having a dearly loved husband who has his own health problems, who faces adversities of many kinds, she still has joy. Judy exudes joy because even when things are hard, her hope and her peace are in a resurrected Christ, and her joy is infectious. Dear friend, I hope that you have that kind of joy, and I hope that you will share your joy that comes from the Lord with others. What a great testimony and witness that is. Number four, the resurrection of Jesus moves us on to mission. The women were invited to come and to see the empty tomb, to look and see the place where Jesus lay. And then they were told, go and tell the disciples that Jesus is alive. Jesus would later appear to the women and say, go, tell my brothers. And later Jesus would tell the disciples, go and tell the world. Today, Jesus wants you and me to go and tell other people. The world needs to know that Jesus is alive, that He died for our sins, that He was buried, and that He rose from the grave. If you will admit to God that you are a sinner, agreeing with God that you have disobeyed Him and that you are guilty before Him, if you will believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and rose from the dead, and if you will confess Him as your Savior and Lord, dear friend, all of your sins will be forgiven. You will be adopted as an eternal child of God, forever accepted into God's family. A home will be prepared for you in heaven, and you'll never be forsaken. I hope you believe that, and I hope you'll receive the gift of salvation. And if you have, I hope you'll go and share that good news with others. Will you give your life to Jesus as your Savior and Lord? Will you believe Christ and receive Him as your crucified and resurrected King? And friend, dear Christian friend, go tell others. Let everything in your life be about spreading this message of the resurrection. Share and show the love of Christ with others. Christ has risen. That is the defining truth of time and eternity. It defines my life. It defines our church. Does it define you? It conquers my fears, and it fills me with joy. And it sets me on a course for the rest of my life, the rest of my days, leading me into eternity, where I hope to join you one day as we gather around the throne of our Savior, singing our praises to Him forever and ever. The one who died for us, the one who rose for us, the one who's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Let's pray. Oh Father, let the resurrection be the defining event for our lives. May the resurrection calm and quiet our fears today. May we be filled with joy because Jesus is alive. Send us out to be a blessing in the world by proclaiming that Jesus died for our sins and He rose from the dead for our salvation, and that He rules and that He reigns today. And we ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Let's sing one more time.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy. I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of His appearing will come.
Friends, thank you so much for joining us today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. We love you and we miss you. I want to close our time together with these words from Colossians 3. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your heart on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things, for you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will appear with Him in glory. Amen. God bless you.